Yesterday's friend, now today's enemy. Now, that was the story in U.S. relations with Saddam Hussein and Manuel Noriega. Add to that list yet another name, Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, the Prime Minister of Afghanistan. A man at the heart of terror in Afghanistan. A man pushed into power by U.S. tax dollars.
Kabul, Afghanistan. Once a city of roses and minarets. Now a scene from hell. This is Kabul after the Soviet withdrawal. This is the Kabul of Afghan Prime Minister Gulbuddin Hekmatyar. Once the CIA's man, he is now turning Afghanistan into a terror nation. Hekmatyar is also into his second year of raining massive rocket and artillery attacks on the citizens of Kabul. It is from this chaos that the Afghan Prime Minister is able to recruit and train international terrorists, seeking out fighters ready to die for jihad. Who is this man, Prime Minister Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, destroying his own capital, encouraging Islamic radicalism around the world? Gulbuddin Hekmatyar is a creation of the intelligence services of the United States and Pakistan. His success, the result of the $1 billion he received from the CIA to fight the Soviets. U.S. support for Hekmatyar grew out of a desire to pull the Soviets into their own Vietnam. The CIA's overall strategy was a brilliant success. After 9 years of fighting, the Soviets bogged down in their own quagmire. The last Soviet troops pulled out in 1989.
While the overall achievement was noble, tactically some errors were made. Some significant errors were made along the way.
Error number one. Largely ignorant of Afghanistan, the CIA and the President Reagan turned to Pakistan to take charge.
The key here is that most American assistance to the Mujahideen was funneled through the Pakistanis.
The Pakistanis showered Gulbuddin Hekmatyar with U.S.-provided weapons and sang his praises to the CIA. They had close ties with Hekmatyar going back to the mid-1970s. Hekmatyar's Islamic fervor played well with the fundamentalist powers of Pakistan.
Their approach was that the assistance would be funneled to those groups that were fighting most effectively against the Soviets. They made the case that Hekmatyar's group was doing that.
That was error number two, buying Pakistan's line that Hekmatyar was effectively fighting the Soviets. In 13 years, Hekmatyar scored no significant battlefield victories and sustained several serious losses.
Gulbuddin is not a battlefield commander. He is a political leader, first and foremost.
Error number three. Washington chose to ignore Hekmatyar's political agenda, his long-standing promotion of Islamic revolution, and the use of terror.
As early as 1981, Afghans from other resistance groups were coming to Washington and telling the stories of Gulbuddin's willingness to have people killed. They told this to government officials, to members of Congress, to anyone who would listen. It was really not a secret.
The CIA turned a blind eye to Hekmatyar's human rights abuses, which were a matter of record. During this time, Hekmatyar made no secret of his contempt for the West, and the United States in particular.
He's made anti-Washington, anti-United States comments for a number of years publicly.
In 1985, Hekmatyar came to the United States on a CIA-paid trip, but he pointedly refused to meet President Reagan, the chief supporter of the Afghan resistance. Another key supporter of the Afghan resistance, Senator Gordon Humphrey, warned Secretary of State James Baker about Hekmatyar in a 1989 letter. Fervent support of Gulbuddin Hekmatyar is clearly not in the United States' interest should he emerge as the strongest player. Astonishingly, Hekmatyar kept the CIA on his side until January 1, 1992, when the CIA's Afghan operation ended. The CIA admits there were concerns about Hekmatyar and the six other Afghan resistance leaders, but these concerns were set aside.
A lot of them weren't people you'd invite home to dinner. The reality is that you had to make do with the strategic situation that you found in Afghanistan.
Now, Hekmatyar has turned against the CIA. At his heavily fortified headquarters 15 miles south of Kabul, Hekmatyar told CNN that allegations of terrorism are a CIA plot against him.
This was part of a propaganda plan against upon Mujahid.
Today, Hekmatyar continues to shell his capital with stockpiled weapons given him by the CIA. Despite the bombardment, Hekmatyar has yet to capture Kabul. It is here in the ruins of the historic Darulaman Palace, more than 5 miles southwest of Kabul, that Prime Minister Hekmatyar occasionally comes to the office. Despite his threats, promises, and compromises, this is the closest the Premier has yet made it to the center of power. Did the U.S. have to back such a man? Were there other Afghans less despotic and more pro-Western?
Who may have been more pro-Western, and also who may have been had a broader base of support amongst the Afghan people, such as the forces of Ahmad Shah Massoud.
Ahmad Shah Massoud has certainly been the foremost battlefield resistance commander of the war. He is an educated, thoughtful leader, and certainly of all the Afghans thrust forward by the war, certainly he must be considered number one.
Massoud is the one Afghan with the power to thwart Hekmatyar and his ambitions. Starting with a handful of supporters at the beginning of the war, Massoud fought off 9 major Soviet offensives aimed at destroying him. Yet, the CIA largely ignored Ahmad Shah Massoud during the war. Despite pressure from Congress, despite pressure from the State Department, urging support for him. Massoud was too busy fighting the war to lobby for aid from the United States, and the Pakistanis did not trust his independence. But in the end, Massoud was so successful in fighting the Soviets that the Wall Street Journal called him the Afghan who won the Cold War. In the end, it was Massoud, not Hekmatyar, who liberated Kabul from the communists. His forces now control the key installations in the capital. Massoud told CNN he emphatically opposes Hekmatyar's terrorism and always has.
From the first days of the war, Hekmatyar advocated terrorism. From the beginning, I was against terrorism. This argument was the origin of the split between us.
Divided in chaos, Afghanistan continues to attract Islamic radicals, a situation aggravated by income from a booming narcotics trade. Now, Massoud is reaching out to the United States and the West to help end the crisis.
The West has two concerns. First, terrorist bases, and second, narcotics. Without Western support for the central government of Afghanistan, there is no way to stop narcotics or terrorism.
The United States cannot afford to ignore Afghanistan. Instability in Afghanistan is not in the interests of the United States. It is in the interests of those who promote Islamic revolution.
We ignore Afghanistan today, really at our peril. And if Afghanistan was in the headlines in the late 1980s, for all the right reasons, Afghanistan may well be in the headlines for all the wrong reasons in the 90s if some of these issues aren't addressed.